planning colleagues really must know better idea around the impact of that on any decision you might make.
Could you just tell us about the road safety in that area? Is it, what sort of background do you have, please?
I have discussed this application at length with our road safety manager, and we looked at the accident record for this area. And so there is nothing in the accident record for this area that leads us to believe that this application, if it were to be approved, would have a detrimental impact on that record.
Thank you. Yes,
there is a land issue here between two owners. We understand that is a private legal matter, and that is not a private matter in terms of consideration of this application. And as my colleague Keith has said, if that wasn't available, the access to this development in our view is still acceptable.
Thank you. I'm just going to ask the solicitor to come on.
The land ownership issue is a private law matter. It'll be for the developer to ensure that they have the access rights over the land before they commence development. If they don't have that, then they may need to come back at some further stage for an amendment to the permission. But it certainly is a private law matter and isn't a material planning consideration.
Thank you. I'm going to open this up to Chris now. Anybody want to say anything? Can I go to Irene first and I'll let you sit used to?
Thank you, Chair. It says on page 44 you've got 22 of the proposed houses in this proposal would constitute inappropriate in green belt. And you said it's not setting a precedent. The other thing I would like to say is about the horses. I'm concerned with the reported near misses of the accidents. My daughter used to ride, and horses, I know that horses are very sensitive, and they're often nervous creatures, and they can easily be stupid. And I am worried about that. It could cause accidents with the increase in traffic.
Thank you,
Steve. David, in your opening description, you talked about Section 106 agreement, and did you use the word phasing in that statement? Can I ask the question that whatever the decision, if the decision is approved, or that the work on Storm Hall would have to happen prior to the development of the housing, or is it simultaneous? But I've got in the back of mind another application where I tried to get something like that fit into the approval and I failed. So I just want to know before we enter the discussion what that actually means, that 106 agreement.
So yes, I did use the word phasing. So what we mean by that is in the Section 106 agreement, there are certain works needed to be done to the hall before housing can be occupied. We're just stepping on like that. So it's works housing, and it goes through that process. Now that's a common approach that we've used on other applications, and what it ensures is obviously that the works that you're seeking to go through the enabling development have actually done and completed, and you don't have a situation where, for example, you do all the housing first and then nothing happens to create the enabling development. So we structure it like that legally, and that is enforceable.
Thanks for that.
Thanks. Anybody else? Can I take Stuart? And you?
I'm trying not to get thrown down the cul-de-sac, the traffic. I think I start, you start by looking at an application like this on the basis of it being a departure from the plan. And then go very seriously into the policy and see what the requirement is. And as has been said, 22 of the dwellings are in land designated as greenbelt, and to allow a development in that land is to show very special circumstances. So I'll come back to that, because I think that's, it's around that question that our decision, I think, needs to take. I was conscious of the numbers David gave in the presentation, that 22 of the 27 new houses fall into that category, which implies that 5 do not. So 5 clearly fall within policy GB7, which refers specifically to villages like Stores, or Stores in Eastern Turfy Village, which allows us to consider limited infill. I had a look before I came to the committee at the boundaries of that, as far as it related to Stone Village. And it's a very tightly drawn boundary, which says to me that, you know, we're not in the business under GB7 of expanding the settlement to a point that, if you like, becomes unsustainable for the settlement and changes its character. And I think that's an area that I'll probably come back to later. Let me first say about the enabling aspect of it. When the applicant made his presentation, he tried to persuade us that the enabling part of the development was purely associated with the works to Stoneport and the barn instead of not being listed or in any way. Although I've sort of been slightly more careful in that, which the enablement is to do with the hall, the bar, and the relocation of the equestrian facilities. And that relocation that I was more interested in when I was looking down the viability assessment, because it's very clear that at least 3/4 of the enablement money is associated with the relocation of the horses. So I'm wondering whether I'm looking at a scheme that creates a equestrian facility, and then as an added extra, gives you 2 flats within the shell of within the shell of Storm Hall. And certainly that's the way the assessment looked to me, and to that extent is unsatisfactory in my mind. I hear what's said about the assessments having been looked at by Historic England. That one's tempted to say Historic England tends to be fairly blinking. It has an amazing dash, if you like, and that's to protect the building itself and the rest of it. But I guess from that point of view, we can probably go hang. But in terms of our own people, Christine Muscat, which is probably fair to our own independent assessor in those reports, all they can look at is the figures as put to them, land values, the allowances made for contingency, for risk, whether there is any risk. Councillor Williams makes the point that no reason to doubt that any house builder will sell, you know, fairly British will be desirable residents. So one wonders what the level of risk in terms of settling the danger of properties lying empty will be. And of course, the more thorny issue of the profit margin that the developer is permitted to. And when our independent assessors will look at that, they will just look at, you know, what's happening in other parts of the country, not necessarily in the context that we have. They will say, well, this tends to be what it is. And there's no real question in issues, for example, of land value. So I make that point. Certainly, it's a shame that assessment is commercially confidential, hasn't been shared, so that sort of challenge could be added in an open environment, but there we are where we are. So coming back, conclusively, to this issue of special circumstances, has it been demonstrated? And in deciding that, we need to weigh what the benefit is against what the potential detriment is. The benefit, as far as I can see, is that the hall will have some sort of end use, or there will be, looking for the plant, 2 flats inserted, if you like, completely inserted within the